All right, so today, Thiago found a really relevant clip from The Lion King, which connects very well to everything that we've been talking about.
Yeah, it sure does, because we are talking about embracing discomfort, embracing your fears, maybe. And those of you who know the story of The Lion King, you know, Simba's father dies when he is young, trying to save him, and Simba feels guilty about this, so he runs away, and he grows up away from his home. But then, in order for him to get back home and, you know, do what he has to do, which is, you know, becoming king, yeah, he has to face his past, which is uncomfortable and painful. And then in this scene, Rafiki, which is kind of a mentor to him, yeah, helps him realize this, like, hey, yes, it is painful and uncomfortable, but in order for you to realize your true potential and become the all you can be, you have to do it. You have to go to that place. Yeah. So we're gonna watch the first clip here and see what happens.
What was that? The weather. Very peculiar, don't you think?
Yeah. Looks like the winds are changing.
Change is good.
Yeah, but it's not easy. I know what I have to do, but going back means I'll have to face my past. I've been running from it for so long. Ow! Jeez, what was that for?
It doesn't matter. It's in the past.
That's such a beautiful movie, man.
It really is, yeah. It's no surprise that it's one of the most popular Disney movies of all time. So he said that the weather's peculiar there. What does it mean if something is peculiar?
It's one of a kind. It's different.
It's unusual, right?
Unusual, yeah. It doesn't happen so often. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And there was some nice connective speech there. So Simba says, but it's not easy. And he has an American tea there. He drops the tea in its, so it becomes buttis, mm-hmm. buttis. And then in not, we have another American tea. So it's T between two vowels where it turns into a D sound. So it becomes not easy, not easy.
Yeah, but it's not easy. Yeah, but it's not easy.
And also the next phrase right after that, there was some nice connected speech. So he says, I know what I have to do, but he... And he doesn't say it that way. He says, what I have to do.
I know what I have to do, but...
We have what I. So there's another American T there happening between these two words. And this would happen also, if, for example, if you had but I. It changes, at least if it's American saying it, to what I or but I.
I know what I have to do, but... I know what I have to do, but...
For example, I'm... at an astronomy class or something like that, mm-hmm. then you could say add in. So what I, but I, add in, any time where we have this T between two vowels. So he says, I know what I have to. So this is really interesting. It becomes, when we have to, oftentimes it will morph to have to. I know what I have to do. And then finally, but ends in a T, and oftentimes we will convert to this when it ends in a word and it's followed by a consonant, or as is here, it's followed by kind of like a pause in the phrase. It becomes but. So I know what I have to do, but.
I know what I have to do, but. I know what I have to do, but.
And then he says that he's been running from his past for so long.
Been running from it for so long.
What does it mean if you are running from something?
Yeah, this is a nice expression first, that when you run from something, you try to escape it. You don't face it. You run away or you run from it. And he's also using a nice grammatical structure here. He says, I've been running from it for so long. This is what we call the present perfect continuous, and it's formed by have been or has been, and the verb in the ing, the main verb. So I've been running, I've been doing, I've been going. So we use that structure when you talk about an action or activity that started in the past, but it's still true now, in the present moment. And your focus here is also on the duration of the activity, not on the activity itself. Because, you know, here he says for so long. That's the emphasis of the sentence. He's focusing on how it's been a long time that he has been running from his past, right? So you can say for here. For example, I've been working at this company for 5 years. Or you can also use since. I've been working at this company since 2010.
And what would be the difference between, for example, if you said, I was running from it for so long, and I've been running from it for so long?
If you use it in the past, I was running from it for so long, I understand that you were doing it, but now you're not doing it anymore. So now, you know, you've decided to face it. You were running from it, but now you're not doing it anymore. If you say, I have been doing it, I have been running, even today, you still haven't stopped doing that.
Nice. So we have the continuation of that clip. Let's take a look.
Ow! Jeez, what was that for?
It doesn't matter. It's in the past.
Yeah, but it still hurts.
Oh, yes, the past can hurt. But the way I see it, you can either run from it or learn from it. Ah, you see? So what are you going to do?
First, I'm going to take your stick.
No.
Nice lesson there, yeah?
Yeah, Rafiki is a great teacher.
Yeah.
Let's see, we have another connected speech there, but it still hurts, right? Again, this is the American T, but it, we talked about that earlier, and then still hurts. Even you could have the T be a bit silent and hurts. So instead of saying a strong hurts, you could say hurts. So it's very subtle there.
Yeah, but it still hurts.
Following that, he says, Rafiki says, the way I see it. What does it mean if you say the way I see it?
This is a great phrase you can use when you want to give your opinion. It's a nice alternative to the phrase, in my opinion. You can say, in my opinion, but you can also say, well, the way I see it, blah, 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 and then give your opinion. So it's a nice variation there for that.
In my opinion, it sounds a bit more formal or a bit more, it's something you'd use more in writing. And even nowadays, we'll do an abbreviation. If you're doing a work correspondence, for example, you might say IMO or IMHO. It's like in my humble opinion, which makes it more humble. It makes it even more like, you know, this is just the way I see things. I know it might not be the truth. Those can be really great abbreviations to use if you work in English and you have to often write. But the way I see it, I think to me, that sounds much more conversational than if you say, in my opinion, this can help you to sound more natural if you were actually speaking to someone. And then a nice structure that Rafiki used here that I've seen a lot of learners actually will make mistakes with. For example, I think Spanish and Portuguese speakers will make the same mistake of saying like or if it's in the negative, nor. But in fact, in English, we have two words that you need to use in this phrasing, which are either or in the negative, neither nor. So do you want to explain exactly what this means, Thiago?
Yeah, basically when you present, let's say, two options or two alternatives to someone. So, for example, hey, are you hungry? Great. We can either have sushi or Japanese.
That was, you know, sushi and Japanese. That's the same thing, right? Let me say that again.
We can either have sushi or Chinese for dinner today. You see, so either sushi or Chinese. Also, what's interesting is the pronunciation, because I think Rafiki in the clip, he says either, which is a possible way of pronouncing it. But you can also go either, depending on the speaker. Yeah, so you might be either or either, but yeah, both are fine.
And you could respond to that person saying, I neither want Chinese nor Japanese food. Can we have something else? So
that is a good one. It's the negative one, right?
It's the negative, yeah. To me, that sounds rather formal. I'd probably say like, I don't want either of them or neither of those sound good. But you know, if you're using a negative, maybe negatively talking about two things, it's neither raining nor sunny. You know, so it's, you can imagine it's cloudy out, right?
Yeah, it does sound more advanced. Yeah, maybe for writing is an excellent structure to use. Yeah,
most definitely.
But you see, I mean, the point of this clip is exactly that. Like, you know, we are talking about embracing discomfort and embracing fear. And that's what Rafiki is helping Simba to do. Yes, the past can hurt, but you can either learn from it or run from it. Yeah, so then, you know, Simba is convinced that he has to go back, face his past, and do what he has to do.
So at some point you have to stop running from your fears, be that, you know, having to face your past, like in The Lion King, or simply having to go and have a conversation with someone in English. That's a paralyzing fear for some people. At some point, if it's something that's really important to you, you're going to have to say, you know, enough is enough. I'm going to stop running from it. I'm going to face my fears.
There you go. Yes. Hey, so this is the end of this lesson. But if you enjoyed learning English vocabulary and pronunciation with it, you should know that this clip was just a part of an episode of the Real Life English podcast. And we release a new episode every week. So come check it out right now by clicking here on this video.